Hello friends, now let us continue our discussion on benign prostatic hyperplasia. So I thought I will discuss before going into the investigations. I thought I will discuss about one of the most important thing, which is bladder outflow obstruction. So that would end with all the symptomatology of benign prostatic hyperplasia. Because benign prostatic hyperplasia is one of the cause for bladder outflow obstruction. Here, this is the bladder. So, in benign prostatic hyperplasia, whenever there is hyperplasia of here, there is outflow obstruction. So, this event causes outflow obstruction. So, what is bladder outflow obstruction? There is some obstruction in the bladder, outflow. So, here in the urinary pathway, there is some obstruction, right? So, but how do you clearly classify something as bladder outflow obstruction? Here, this is a urodynamic concept. Uro is urine, dynamic is flow. Urodynamic concept. Based on mainly the combination of here, there will be low flow rates. There is low urinary flow. Despite of high voiding pressure. Whenever there is high voiding pressure, there should be increased flow rate, right? But still, despite of high voiding pressure, there is low flow rate. So there is basically increased pressure. Despite of this pressure, the urine which is present here, very little is dribbling out. Okay, that is called as bladder outlet obstruction. So how do you diagnose it? The major way of diagnosing is pressure flow studies. Pressure flow studies can be done to diagnose it. We'll see how much pressure does it say, with how much pressure does it contract, and we would also record the flow of urine during that time. So what are the major causes of bladder outflow obstruction? Okay, there are three major mechanical causes, mechanismal causes of bladder outflow obstruction. One is detrusor instability. The detrusor muscle is not normal or it is not stable. Number two, neurological dysfunction. Sympathetic and parasympathetic pathway is not normal. And number three, weak bladder contraction. All these may lead to the symptoms. But if you see, if you notice, if there is detrusor instability, there is detrusor flow, then there is which symptoms? Lower urinary tract symptoms, obviously, right? But I thought of specifying it clearly, right? If you see detrusor instability, if there is some detrusor instability, then it cannot contract. So there won't be high voiding pressure. Similarly, when there is urological dysfunction, there is no pressure at all. Whenever there is weak bladder contraction, then the voiding pressure is low. So here, there is low voiding pressure. So there is low flow rate. So there are two major entities. Number one, there is high voiding pressure and high flow rate. Number two, there is low voiding pressure and low flow rate. So these are not the causes of bladder outflow obstruction. So these are the major differential diagnosis of lower urinary tract symptoms. So to differentiate between these and this one, bladder outflow this pressure flow studies were done in order to differentiate between these three, which are due to low voiding pressure, and this one, which is due to high voiding pressure. We generally take pressure flow studies, right? So what are the major causes of bladder outflow obstruction? What are the proven bladder outflow obstructions till now? BOO is bladder outflow obstruction, right? Number one, benign prostatic hyperplasia. Okay, let me draw it in a form of diagram. That would be better than just writing it. Number one, benign prostatic hyperplasia. Okay, next. Number two, bladder neck stenosis. Right here, there is no problem in detrusor, there is no neuromuscular junction abnormality, or there is no neurological problems. There are just these problems, and there are just mechanical obstructions. Number three, bladder neck hypertrophy. Okay. Number four, prostate cancer. And then this is urethra, so urethral strictures. And finally, functional obstruction due to neuropathic condition. It's not normal mechanical obstruction, but there is functional obstruction due to some other condition. So all these are mechanical obstructions. Okay, so these are the proven bladder outlet obstructions. So what are the major effects, primary effects of bladder outflow obstruction? So primary effects, what does it really lead to? What does this bladder outflow obstruction lead to? Number one, there is decreased urinary flow rate, right? That is obstruction. Though there is pressure, because of obstruction, there is decreased urinary flow rate. I don't want to know all those values, so I'm not writing any of those values. And number two, there is increased voiding pressure. Though there is increased voiding pressure, there is decreased urinary flow rates. Now, what are the long-term effects? What happens later? If this goes on after some years, what really happens? So, long-term effects of bladder outflow obstruction. Okay, what really happens is number one, if this is the bladder and here there is urethra, so whenever there is some obstruction here, I'm not knowing that there are many causes of obstruction, so what really happens is slowly the detrusor muscle contraction decreases. Inefficiency. So once this detrusor muscle contraction decreases, there is development of residual urine, because all the urine which is filled in the bladder cannot void out, right? So there is residual urine develops. So this is the long-term effect, number one. Number two, Sometimes there may be detrusor overactivity. Because it tries to empty the whole urine which is present, even the residual urine. This may cause detrusor overactivity. Because of this detrusor overactivity, and even though there is detrusor overactivity, there is decreased functional capacity. That is, the amount of urine that is voided decreases. That is, amount of urine voided decreases. As this occurs, both of these leads to irritable bladder. Bladder becomes irritable. So these are the major long-term effects of bladder outlet obstruction. Okay? Now, what are the complications of bladder outlet obstruction? Okay, complications. These are very simple. There is some obstruction here. So because of obstruction, number one, if it is acute obstruction, there may be acute retention of urine. Okay, that is one. And number two, sometimes there is chronic retention of urine. Okay, number three, impaired bladder emptying. The bladder cannot empty. The urine does not flow out completely, so there is impaired bladder emptying. And sometimes there is hematuria. And sometimes because of this retention, there is a chance of stone formation. And because of this retention, there may be chance of carcinoma in situ because of metaplasia, dysplasia. So carcinoma in situ of bladder can occur. Okay, so these are the major complications of bladder outlet obstruction. Okay, so these are what we should learn from this. So let me draw the diagrams of pressure flow studies which are used for diagnosis. So in pressure flow studies, if you see, okay, I'll draw it in my next page. Next page, so that you'll clearly understand. So, number one, flow. Let me draw the flow. It is first there is zero flow, and then the flow increases, and then it decreases, and then normal. So this is what normal is. This is about flow. And now volume. Whenever the pressure of the flow pressure, basically. Flow is pressure, basically. The pressure which you give is this. Whenever the pressure is there, so this will, the volume will decrease. Okay, next, in bladder outflow obstruction, what happens? In bladder outflow obstruction, sorry, this is not pressure, this is just a flow. How much the urine flows. Okay. The in bladder outlet obstruction, the flow is very less. The volume voided is also very less. Okay. So this is what generally happens. There is decreased flow rate and there is low voided volume. Okay. Normal voided volume is this. This is normal flow. Here there is decreased flow rate and there is decreased voided volume. Okay, so these are the major things which you should learn. And now, what are assessment of the patient with lower urinary tract infections is done in next class. Okay guys, this is about benign prostatic hyperplasia. In my next class, I will teach you about the investigations and treatment of benign prostatic hyperplasia. Thank you guys for watching my video.